Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Ferrens Art Gallery. We are pleased to be giving a performance here. It's in conjunction with Hull College, Hull University, the Hull Heritage Learning Centre, the Arts Council, City of Culture and Ferrens Art Gallery. We are the Hull Folk Collective, and as you can see, I am the ship's master. I've got my merry crew here, John, Rose and Jerry, and someone who have press ganged off the street, Andy. We are the Hull Folk Collective. For hundreds of years, the rivers and sea have been the highways of folk. Dangerous places where ordinary people have bravely battled the elements, fishing, whaling, carrying cargo and travelling. All of the activities we nowadays take for granted. Often, mariners travelled in vessels not fit for purpose. Often, they endured terrible hardships. Many lives were lost. With our songs, we will pay homage to these brave men and women of the sea. Report from the Hull Advertiser and Exchange Gazette, 20th of December 1821. Extraordinary shipwreck. The American South Seaman Essex of 250 tons, G. Pollard Master from Nantucket, being on the 19th of November 1820 in latitude 47 degrees south, longitude 118 degrees west, was struck by a whale of the largest class, which knocked part of a keel off just abreast the main channels. The animal remained for some time alongside, endeavouring to clasp the ship with her jaws, but could not accomplish it.
Stood on the quarter deck, and the song
1866, the whaling ship Diana became stuck in the ice. 14 months after setting out, she returned. Diana was Hull's last venture into whaling. Report from the Elgin Courier, 12th of April, 1867. Arrival of a missing whale ship, Diana. Dreadful sufferings of the crew. The sight which met the eyes of the people from the shore cannot well be told in prose. Dante might have related it in the Inferno. Coleridge's Ancient Mariner might have sailed in such a ghastly ship. Battered and ice-bruised, sails and cordage blown away, boats and spars all cut up for fuel in the awful Arctic winter. The main deck, a charnel house not to be described. The miserable, scurvy-stricken, dysentery-worn men who looked over their bulwarks were a spectacle, once to be seen, never to be forgotten. As the tidings of a ship's arrival went through Shetland, the relatives of her crew journeyed to meet their living and to claim their dead, and buy instalments as they were fit to be removed. The survivors were brought to Lerwick or to their homes in the island. Some not to be transported are still in the ship, but the bulk of the survivors have left her. Most pitiable sights of all were the ship's boys, with their young faces wearing an aged look, not easily to be described.
Boys return to sea.
excerpt from The Rime of the Ancient Mariner by Samuel Taylor Coleridge, 1834. At length did cross an albatross, through the fog it came, as if it had been a Christian soul. We hailed it in God's name. It ate the food it ne'er had, and round it flew. The ice did split with a thunder fit. The helmsman steered us through.
For the southern ocean is a lonely place, where the storms are many and the shelters scarce.
Down upon the southern ocean sailing, down below Cape Horn,
against the troubled waters and a problem sky, you can see the Mollymook wheel and fly.
Down upon the southern down upon the southern ocean sailing.
advertisement in the Hull Advertiser and Exchange Gazette. Friday, 14th of July, 1848. Shipping to sail about the 30th inst for Bombay direct. The splendid and fast-built British sailing ship William Darley, Henry Camel, master. For freight or passage, apply to Brownlow, Pearson & Co., the owners, or to Thomas Thompson & Sons, merchants. Hull, 12th of July, 1848.
I've traded with the Maoris, Brazilians and Chinese. I've courted dark-eyed beauties beneath the kauri trees. I've travelled along with a laugh and a song in a land where they call you mate. Who would sail the seven seas and share a sailor's fate? Across the line, the Gulf Stream, I'm here in Table Bay. Around the Horn and home again, for that is the sailor's. Without a pilot port, longboats lowered by candlelight, pushed out and gently oared, rowlocks creaking, a thumping swell, a wind that would make you ache. Who would sail the seven seas and share
gangs. The scandalous outrages that have been committed by press gangs call for the immediate interference of the Board of Admiralty. Custom and state necessity authorise the practice of impressing seamen, but it was never intended that persons not accustomed to a seafaring life and pursuing useful industry should be deprived of their liberty, dragged like felons through the streets, beat and cut with hangers, and put on board a tender, merely because it pleased a set of ruffians called a press gang.
Oh, the weary cutters, and oh, the weary sea. Oh, the weary cutters have taken my true love from me. They've pressed in far away foreign with Nelson beyond the salt sea. They pressed him far away foreign. They stole my love from me. Oh, them lousy cutters have taken my true love from me. Yes, those lousy cutters have taken my true love from me. They always come in the night, they never come in the day. They come in the night and steal our men folk away. Oh, the weary cutters, and oh, the weary sea. Oh, the weary cutters have taken my love from me. I'll give them cutters a guinea, but I can't give them cutters no more. I will give them cutters a guinea to bring my love ashore. Oh, I'll give them cutters a guinea, but I can't give them cutters no more. I will give them cutters a guinea to bring my love ashore.
Southern Reporter and Cork Commercial Courier, 18th of July, 1844. Navy movements. A correspondent writing from Clifton on the 10th inst states that a gentleman who had been the preceding day in Innis Boffin heard from the chief boatsman of a station in that island that a fleet of 18 large ships consisting of men of war and frigates had just been seen off the coast, steering in the south. Two war steamers had been seen in Ardbeg Bay during the week, and such were the alternating rumours amongst the people that many people would not sleep in their houses lest they be visited by press gangs during the night.
As I walked up Paul's old high street, a bold press gang I chanced to meet.
They forced me then to join the fleet. On board a man of war.
Pray, brother sailors, and tell me true what sort of usage they gave you.
That I may know before I go on board a man of war, boy.
But when I got there, to my surprise, all that they had told me was shocking lies.
And there was a row and a
Advertisement in the Caledonian Mercury, Tuesday, the 17th of July, 1733. Advertisements for the benefit of the herring fishing and to encourage boats to come to try it. There is to be a course of boats around the Isle of May, beginning from the town of Crail, going to the westward, round the isle, coming in to the eastward. The boats are to be manned with their ordinary crews, and none to be allowed but who carry the ordinary complement of nets, etc. The prize for the first boat to be £5, 50 shillings to the second, and the third, 25 shillings, all sterling money. The 10th of August is proposed for the day, wind and weather serving. In case of fishing well, the day will be delayed to the contentment of the fishers.
Please join in on the chorus. Oh, what do we do with the herring's head? Oh, what do we do with the herring's head? We'll make them into loaves of bread. Herring's head, loaves of bread, and all manner of things. Of all the fish that's in the sea, the herring is the one for me. How are you the day? How are you the day? How are you the day? Puddings and pies, herring's eyes, puddings and pies, herring's head, loaves of bread, and all manner of things. Of all the fish that's in the sea, We'll turn them into needles and pins. Herring's fins, needles and pins. Herring's eyes, puddings and pies. Herring's head, loaves of bread. And all manner of things. Of all the fish that's in the sea, the herring is the one for me. Harry the day, Harry the day, Harry the daily in the yard.
What do we do when the herring's back?
Oh, what do we do when the herring's back? We'll turn them into a lad called Jack. Herring's back, a lad called Jack. Herring's fins, needles and pins. Herring's eyes, puddings and pies. Herring's head, loaves of bread. And all manner of things. Of all the fish that's in the sea, the herring is the one for me. Harry the day, Harry the day, Harry the day, me in the yard.
Oh, what do we do in the herring's belly?
Oh, what do we do in the herring's belly?
We'll turn it into a lass called Nelly.
Herring's belly, a lass called Nelly. Herring's back, a lad called Jack. Herring's fins, needles and pins. Herring's eyes, puddings and pies. Herring's head, loaves of bread. And all manner of things. Of all the fish that's in the sea, the herring is the one for me. Harry the day, Harry the day, Harry the day, me in the yard.
Oh, what do we do when the herring's tails?
Oh, what do we do when the herring's tails?
We turn them into a boat that sails.
Herring's sails, a boat that sails. Herring's belly, a lass called Nelly. Herring's back, a lad called Jack. Herring's fins, needles and pins. Herring's eyes, puddings and pies. Herring's head, loaves of bread. And all manner of things. Of all the fish that's in the sea, the herring is the one for me. Harry the day, Harry the day, Harry the day, me in the yard.
Report from the Hull Daily Mail, 12th of February, 1889. A fisherman drowned. George Hart, the master of the Heroine, states that at 9 o'clock on Saturday morning, 65 miles from Spain, the crew was engaged in changing the vessel's course when she shipped a heavy sea, which carried three of her men overboard. Two of them were saved, but the third hand, named Joseph Monckton, aged 31, unmarried, was drowned before assistance could reach him.
Methinks I see a host of craft spreading their sails alee, as down the Humber they do glide, all abound for the northern sea. Methinks I see on each small craft a crew with hearts so brave, going out to earn their daily bread upon the restless waves. And it's 10 boys and men were lost from Grimsby town, from Yarmouth town to Scarborough, many hundreds more were drowned. Our herring craft, our trawlers, our fishing smacks as well, they long defied that bitter night and battle with the swell.
Methinks I see them yet again as they leave the land behind, casting their nets into the deep, the fishing shoals to find. I see them yet again, and all on board, all right. With the sails close reefed and the decks cleared up, and the side lights burning bright, and it's 80 boys and men were lost from Grimsby town, from Yarmouth down to Scarborough, many hundreds more were drowned. A herring craft, our trawlers, our fishing smacks as well, they long defied that bitter night and battle with the swell.
Methinks I hear the captain say, me lads will shorten sail, for the sky to all appearances it looks like an approaching gale.
Methinks I see them yet again, and the midnight hour is past. Those little craft are battling there against the icy blast. It's 80 boys and men were lost from Grimsby town, from Yarmouth town to Scarborough, many hundreds more were drowned. Our herring craft, our trawlers, our fishing smacks as well, they long defied that bitter night and battle with the swell.
October's night brought such a sight, it was never seen before. There was masts and yards, and the broken spars came a-floating to our shores. There was many a heart of sorrow, there was many a heart so brave, there was many a fine and a hearty lad in fine a watery grave.
And it's 80 boys and men were lost from Grimsby town, from Yarmouth town to Scarborough, many hundreds more were drowned. Our herring craft, our trawlers, our fishing smacks as well, they long defied that bitter night and battle with the swell.
Thank you. I'd like to dedicate that last song to a gentleman, Mally Hollich, who was sadly taken from us this year and who was a regular at the Minerva sessions and in the Black Boy.
Cheers, Mally.
And two men who went missing from Scarborough yesterday from the scene. Some ports ran apprentice schemes for young lads in the warehouses. These were not ideal. Report from the Canterbury Union Workhouse, 15th of October, 1884. Boy complains that he dislikes sea. Has no complaint against anyone, but he had 16 months trial. Told he must make another trip. Skipper states boy has always been afraid of the sea from the beginning, but was also afraid of going back to the Union. Life at sea for everyone was harsh, cruel, and dangerous.
With our nets and gear we're faring on the wild and waste.
blissful ocean. It's there on the deep nut we harvest and reap our bread.
While we're following them shores of herring.
Oh, it was a fine and a pleasant day. Out of Yarmouth Harbour I was faring. As a cabin boy on a sailing lugger,
for to go and hunt the shores of herring.
Although what was hard, and the hours were long, and the treatment sure it took some bearing, there was little kindness, and the kicks were many.
As we hunted for the shoals of herring,
oh, we fished the swath and the broken bank. I was cook and I'd a quarter sharing, and I used to sleep standing on my feet.
And I dream about the shoals of herring.
To Canny Shield we soon were bearing, with 100 crown of the silver diamonds
we'd taken from the shoals of herring.
Now you're up on deck, you're a fisherman, you can swear and show a manly bear. Take your turn on watch with the other fellows while you're
searching for the shoals of herring.
In the stormy seas and the living gales, just to earn your daily bread, your daring. From the Dover Straits to the Faroe Islands,
and we're following the shoals of herring. Oh, I earn my keep and I pay my way, and I earn the gills I was wearing. Sail a million miles or 10 million fishes. We were sailing after shoals of herring.
Apart from one song, that brings us to the end of today. I'd like to thank Ferrens Art Gallery for having us here, Hull College, Hull University for inviting us, and to everyone here for coming and listening to us. We were homeward bound one night on the deep, swinging in my hammock I fell asleep. I dreamed concerning Franklin and all his crew. With 100 seamen he sailed away to the frozen ocean in the month of May, to seek the passage around the pole, where we poor sailors do sometimes go. Through cruel hardships they vainly strove, their ships unbound mountains of ice was drove. Only the Eskimo in his skin canoe was the only one that e'er came through. In Baffin's Bay, where the whale fish blow, the fate of Franklin no man may know. The fate of Franklin no tongue can tell. Lord Franklin alone with his sailors does dwell. And now me hardship, it gives me pain. For me long lost Franklin, I'd cross the main. £1,000 I would freely give for the one on earth who says, my Franklin do live.
Thanks very much, everyone.